Good morning and thank you for joining us here on Citizen TV's Cheche, the show where opinion counts. I'm your host, Odwa Kamimo. Now, today's guest wants to restore Nairobi, Kenya's capital, to its former glory, its green city in the sun days. We all know that won't be easy. A legacy of poor public services, poor planning, and corruption are some of the challenges Nairobi faces. But His Excellency Dr. Evans Kidero is facing his own personal challenges, namely a petition questioning his election as governor and doubts about his loyalty to the ODM party which he belongs to. Nevertheless, he insists that he will deliver on his promise of a better city and a better life for Nairobi. So we'll hear how far he's come on that pledge. I also have with me in the Cheche studio our regular panel, Mutegi Njau of Royal Media Services and political commentator David Makali. So good morning and welcome to the program. We have to congratulate you first because, of course, you're the first governor of the capital city, Nairobi, and that's not an easy thing to be. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Amimo.
So better life, better city. How far have you come on that? Well, how has life in Nairobi changed for Nairobians since you became governor?
Amimo, we were elected. I was elected about four months ago. And probably the challenges that I'm facing probably are a little bit more than I'd anticipated, because when I was going in, I wasn't aware that the wage bill was higher than the income, leave alone the operational expenses. I was not aware that we have debts in billion shillings, in excess of 40 billion shillings. But of course, I mean, we are owed the same amount of money. And then, obviously, the first quarter, the money that was supposed to come from central government actually did not come. Only the money that came was the setting up for the offices. So, obviously, the challenges that we face because of lack of money did not deter us from obviously getting on with works. I mean, my promise to Nairobians of ensuring the adequacy of water, decongesting the city, ensuring that
sanity. You've outlined the challenges. You've told us what you intend to do, but you haven't told us what you've done in the 4 months since you've been.
That's exactly what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. That in the 4 months we've been able to increase water supplies to the various parts.
Our viewers will tell us whether that's true.
I'll tell you. In Soweto, in Embakasi, mm-hmm. we put in a big pipe from Kirigiti. People in Kawa West who'd never seen water. Kids in Standard 4 had never had water flowing through their taps from the time they were born, are now getting water.
Okay.
On security, we've been able to start the program of
Safer Initiative.
The Safer Initiative, and we are putting CCTVs all over in phase one of the CBD, and later on we'll go to phase two, phase three, and phase four.
We'll come back to that because David, you look skeptical.
It is sad that Kidero actually said that there is water for Nairobians, because a lot of Nairobians are not getting water. I don't get water in my house at all. I have to buy water. And that is not just, I'm not an exception. In the area I live, a lot of people are buying water because water has been privatized. People collude with the Nairobi Water Company to cut off the supply so they can actually sell the water. Mm. That is a standard practice. So I don't see where the improvement is.
Makali, I mean, what I did say started. I think I chose my words very, very carefully. carefully. Because, I mean, what it is, Nairobi, the amount of water that is needed in Nairobi is about 645,000 cubic meters. Currently, we are pumping 500,000 cubic meters, but we lose 40% in what you call non-revenue water. So we end up with 300. So the amount of water that is available.
What is non-revenue water?
Non-revenue water is the water that you lose, water that you cannot account for.
Mm-hmm.
Is either
bus
through
pipes,
bus pipes, illegal connections. Mm-hmm. And I'll come back to the issue of illegal connection, which I think is fairly rampant. So the total amount of water that gets into Nairobi is 50% of the total requirement. And there are a number of initiatives, and I'm saying that because having recognized that, we had to say in the long term, how are we going to ensure that we achieve the 648,000 cubic meters of water that is required. And of course, the first one is to increase the flow of water. There are a number of initiatives which started when the water reform started, but the capacity for absorption was much lower. And what I'm doing is obviously ensuring that the reform that was started does not lapse, because you know water as a service has now been devolved to the counties, and you know we own Nairobi Water. But previously, the Nairobi Water was not reporting to the then City Council.
Okay, so what reforms are you instituting, and when will people like David get water in their homes?
We're putting up new investments. Like we're doing a huge pipe, a 600-millimeter pipe from Gigiri going to Kabete, and I don't know where David lives.
The issue here is, and you just identified it yourself, it is that 40% of the water is unaccounted for. Illegal connections or people actually tapping it and selling it and all these things. That requires you to crack, to intercept those thieves and criminals who are, you know, diverting the water. What is hard about that?
That's the first thing.
I mean, people from Nairobi City company, the people who provide water, having their private vehicle to sell water.
I know.
If you go to Dagoretti, all those vehicles are owned by Dagoretti Corner. Yeah.
I'll grave aside. The problem is that I have mandated Nairobi Water, the MD, that he must reduce non-revenue water from in the first year from 40% to 25%. We only have 245,000 meters as compared to Kenya Power, which has over 700,000 meters. And there are more houses with water connections than with electricity connection. So that shows us how rampant it is. So, I mean, we've agreed and we put the management of Nairobi Water on a short leash that the water should go to the people that pay for it. And David, as you're saying, that it is in the through that we will reduce the losses to probably undeserving places. But of course, we must accept also that I mean some of these pipes go are more than 70 years old. So we're in the process of renewing the pipes so that we reduce the level of leakages.
Dr. Kidero, my concern is with the corruption in that sector, where we are saying people are running private companies on Nairobi City Council water. And the boozers are all over the place. This is not secret. I mean, you can actually intercept them and say, where is this water from? And you can get out to the problem.
That is true. And I mean, in the informal settlements, water costs 20 times what it costs you and me who have meters, even if it comes in frequently. But probably we pay the right price. But Kibera, Kawangware, Kangemi, Madare, Soweto, Mukuru Kwanjenga, water costs 20 times. And if it happens, we had a maintenance last week where for 2 days we stopped water, the price of water went to 100 times what it costs in the meter. And for me, that's one of the things I've done. I want to ensure that the people who live in the informal settlements are not exploited the way they're being exploited.
So with respect, you're not addressing our questions. You've told us about the slums, and we know all about that because, of course, you campaigned on a platform of change, and you said that you would address corruption. And so the question is, how are you addressing corruption within the Nairobi Water Company? How are you dealing with the people who we see colluding to sell water at those prices? The problems you're outlining, we are familiar with. We live in Nairobi, so how are you addressing them?
Yeah, we are. I mean, we've now employed private investigators who work within this organization. And I mean, I think we've gotten rid of a number of people, both at the Nairobi Water Company
and elsewhere,
and within the county government, which is a successor to the county government. And the objective, and that's why I was saying what we're doing, is if you increase supply, you reduce you'll reduce corruption, because if there is supply, then the propensity to start profiteering because of limited supply of automatically goes. So I think, I mean, the long term one, increasing supplies is the best way to tackle the corruption due to limited supply.
Okay. What are you doing about health services in university, because the clinic, the dispensaries of some of them are sold.
We have Pumwani Hospital. I mean, I've just gone through.
Isn't that one of your quick wins?
I mean, we did something in Pumwani. So far, I've got people, Nairobians, to donate 4 ambulances. Previously, when I went, we didn't have even a single ambulance that was running. And of course, I mean, with the free maternal health, we've seen an influx in the number of women coming from 70 to about 120, 130, about 15-16% of them need to go through operations. So we've put in more beds, bought linen, we've gotten more doctors, I got 7 more doctors, brought in more nurses. But the long term, what we want to do, because Pumwani is the largest maternity hospital, you maybe call it East and Central Africa, is to rehabilitate it, because Pumwani is more than 80, 90 years old. Rehabilitate it, the 350 bed, but also expand it. So to that end, we require about 1.2 billion shillings. And I did put a little bit more than half of that in the current budget. So that process will start this year.
What about other health facilities?
The other health facilities, we have about 69 health centers, and we are going to we have plans on starting to rehabilitate 20 of them this year, and the next in the coming years, and of course increase the medical supplies. What is true as well is that I looked at the books, medicines were being bought, but probably they were not being delivered. They were never getting to the patient.
You talked about security. You said you're in the first phase of CBD.
Electronic surveillance systems.
Right. I'll put a question to you, and this comes from Wanja Juguna. What are you doing with the Inspector General to improve security, first in the CBD and then beyond? When can I start walking from the CBD without knowing that I'm committing suicide? Which is pretty much how a lot of people
feel. When I go to City Hall, Nairobi was actually dark, because I mean lights were not being replaced, and you know, I mean, without lights, that provides propensity for insecurity. We have started making Nairobi a light, and if you wanted to know how dark Nairobi was, you just needed to go to top one of the buildings, and you see, at night it was dark. So the city center CBD is completely lit at the moment, and we are doing that across the city. The second
phase.
The second thing is the number of policemen, and we know that the world average should be 401 policemen to 450 people. Nairobi is one policeman to 1,150 people. So we have agreed with the Inspector General. We're bringing more numbers, and we are taking out the policemen who have been on traffic to go and do the jobs for which they were trained, and even the VIP security, which had absorbed quite a number of people. I mean, I'm sure you're aware that the Inspector General is looking to that, of course, with hue and cry. Last but not least, phase one, we are doing an electronic surveillance system where we are putting in 49 cameras between Uhuru Highway and Nairobi River, University Way, and the railway station.
University Way is notorious for the stealing of lights and mirrors from cars when you're stuck in traffic, which, you know, combines two problems, security, but also traffic congestion. What are you doing about that?
So we're increasing the, we know that where the hotspots are. Mm-hmm. So we are increasing the number of police on patrol in the hotspots. And I mean, you're absolutely right. It's just not university. I mean, probably most of Uhuru Highway, starting from...
Would you actually, Dr. Kidero, say that security has improved? Mm-hmm. Okay, you've been there for months. But in my view, nothing has improved in terms of security. In fact, I think it's getting worse if you look at some of the incidents happening. I think you're coming into office, opened up the gates to people who had run away to come back. It was like a crime holiday within the CBD. Look at the couple that was shot the other day. Broad daylight. People shot and, you know, the criminals disappear and no trace of them. I have seen incidents in this town where people, where, you know, crimes happen. People report to the police. They take an hour to get within the CBD. Moy Avenue I'm talking about. The police spread seems to be below completely the strength you're talking about. So I don't know how you, in your assessment, this looks like an improvement.
No, but you've seen over the last 2 months or so that the police have intensified. I mean, you've seen the number of thugs who have been either arrested or shot. And I might not give you the statistics now, but the number of incidences reported has actually dropped by 30%.
And is it really, do you consider it your duty, or is this still a police duty? You talked about establishing the Nairobi Metropolitan Police to, you know, complement the National Police Service. Is there anything apart from working with the IG that the council or your county administration can do?
Currently, I mean, the first thing, obviously, I'm working with the IG, but the city inspectorate, for it to be able to perform at the level of the Metropolitan Police, would need to be reformed. Actually, I mean, the bad press that the Nairobi former Nairobi City Council got, or we are getting at the moment, has been probably some of the inappropriate actions of the city inspector. So one, I mean, what we'll do is we'll have to retrain them. We'll have to look at the management, or we are looking at the management of that, and bring them at a level where not only they'd be able to perform the jobs, but the public would believe that they can rely on them to perform those jobs.
So an admission, really, that since you came in, you realized the ball game is a bit different from what you thought when you were out, when you promised at election time during the campaign that, I mean, you could do, you know, all these things, Metropolitan Police, you could reform the city within a quick time. Let's do a practical assessment. So far, you think that things are tougher than you thought, right?
The English say the devil is in the detail. And the truth is, I mean, the devil is in the detail. But I'm not saying that it is insurmountable. I mean, we are creating platforms for management and for long-term resolutions.
Okay. Did you not think that cleaning up the city would have been a quick win for you? Because Nairobi is filthy. It used to be very clean. Compared to other capital cities, say, for instance, Kigali, this is still a very dirty city. And we don't have a culture of cleanliness. You know, you find litter everywhere. And the whatever public bins you see are not used. So what are you doing in terms of garbage collection, but just also imputing a culture of hygiene and cleanliness?
It's rather unfortunate and sad that we have to compare ourselves. Actually, I mean, we should be the point of reference where...
We're the biggest economy.
I mean, we are the most learned, we're the most educated, we're the most cultured. So we should be the point of reference. I mean, initially we used to collect about 30% of the garbage. Right now we are collecting up to 70% of the total garbage. We're in the process of... we are building capacity. We are changing people's minds. That's why we've done the last three monthly cleanings, and we'll continue doing that every last Saturday of the month. The main objective being is that people need to be aware. And they say,
are you going to put that in the law? In places like Singapore, you're fined.
We're gonna put that in the. Obviously, I mean the for the longest time we've had it in the city bylaws, but it was with respect to littering. Mm-hmm. With respect to keeping your doorstep clean, it wasn't. We're gonna put it in the city laws that you must keep your doorstep clean. And they said if everybody kept their doorstep clean, we would have a very, very clean world. Of course, we have some archaic laws that you cannot unblock the drainage in front of your house. Currently, you'd go to, the sea, we would arrest you if you unblock the drainage. I mean, we have to do away with such laws because if we want you to keep your doorstep clean, you should be able to clean your drainage as well.
Okay, excellent. We'll take a break now. This is Cheche live on Citizen TV. We're talking about Nairobi. Restoring it to its former glory with the county's first governor, Dr. Evans Kidero. If you've got any questions or opinions for him, you can SMS 22422 or you can tweet at Cheche_TV. When we come back, we'll talk about how national politics could be or may not be affecting his administration.